Just at the start of my career, I was appointed by the National Science Foundation, NWO, in the Netherlands, to set up for their institution the first interdisciplinary research program. It was complete new for a disciplinary institution, but I got a very important person on board, and that was Jan Staman. Who was Jan Staman? Jan Staman was the primary chief advisor in the cabinet of the Minister of Agriculture. So he was dealing with the scientific tensions between research on optimization farmers and also the discussion in society about industrial farming. He told me this: all real important decisions are made by files instead of numbers, to choose your partner, to make or have children, etc. And I was amazed to hear that this is also true at the very high level of the ministries. All important decisions have to do with value. It might be value in political sense, it might be value of personal sense, it might be anyway a value that is driving the motivation of those people to work in a specific direction. Since then, I was very much interested in what is the systematic role of values in our society, and especially in relation to complex societal problems. I'm going to share some insights with you. First, a little bit theory. Here you see the matrix of a theory that is named the communicative action theory. It shows four levels that are actually grouped in two other levels on the right side, as you see over there. It is a first order argumentation, and the other one is the second order argumentation. So what is it all about? Our communication also hides several levels. We don't communicate only words, we also communicate all kinds of data at the same way. This data, actually, is neutral. So you usually see data in all kinds of scientific articles, and you see technical descriptions. And in the technical descriptions, you have to imagine, just like, for instance, when I take my mobile, that you can make a technical description of this mobile, describe the hardware, describing how it works, showing that there's gold inside. That is a technical description. What is interesting, actually, is when you bring this technical description into a context, in a situation, it actually adds meaning. That situational situations is related to me, and when you have a mobile, your mobile is related to you. And when we change our mobiles, we don't change actually a kind of, say, device. No, it is not a device. It is something with a meaning. And that meaning comes because it is situational. It is connected. And this connection is the first starting point of a relationship, and a relationship has some kind of meaning for persons. When we make actually a combination of all the meanings and relationships in the world and around us, to make it simple, in our family, then we come to a system of values. So that is the third level. And then we enter actually the second order of communication. It is about values in a relationship around yourself. So in a network with other people and other objects, there are all kinds of meanings. And that is a system of meaning. And the very last part, actually, step number four, deals with, say, the social rational perspective. For instance, ideas about democracy, about freedom. And these are general, overarching, large value concepts. That is what we strive for. That is what we like to experience daily. Every step needs a reflection. So it is a difficult step to make from just a description, and say what you do as engineer, up to a more social description of what a mobile is actually doing with people. The next step is looking to the whole system and seeing that all kinds of relationships create new kinds of meanings, and when you create new kinds of meanings, all kinds of values come in. And at the end, there's an overarching idea of what is the good life. Here you see a small part of text that is from a newspaper, and I like to ask you just to stop the video, take some your pencil and make some notes, and especially look for words or combination of words that gives you a kind of feeling that matters. That is actually a formulation that pushes me in some kind of direction. That is a message that actually also takes my heart. So when you now stop the video, I return a little bit later when you start again. Okay, I also did the same homework as you did. I made some green markings in this text. And I will discuss with you what is so interesting about this kind of wording, this kind of formulation. For instance, will lead to a better understanding actually means that there is a kind of direction coming in. So that in the future, we will reach better understanding. When it is a kind of promise for the future, it will actually catch you. Better understanding is, of course, much more valued than worse understanding, sure. Obvious, better models is again a suggestive term that say, well, there is a difference between good and bad, and we are now going for the good ones. The other part, like more efficiency, next one, especially a highly valued formulation in Western countries. There are a lot of countries like the Bahamas or countries where there's a mañana culture where efficiency is not that important. So it is specifically for Western countries that high efficiency is very important value statement. And the last one are actually also coming to some general statements. We all want to improve health, isn't it? And we all want to have welfare for animals and reduce greenhouse gas emissions of livestock, yes. So when we return to the theory where I started with, you see actually the several steps of first and second argumentations coming up in this small text. For instance, the top one is typically a technical description of the situation, and the lower one is actually quite a value-laden part of text with a lot of value statements hidden in the text. Interesting to know, but I won't come into in detail in this issue, but you have to realize that in logic it is very well known that the moment when you build in a logical argumentation, so an argumentation from if A then B, if B then C, if C then D, then if D then E, all kind of logical syllogism, and then you enter one syllogism that has a value in it, that the final conclusion of the long row of all kinds of technical statements also turns into a value statement. So one value-laden statement is enough to come to a value-laden conclusion. It's a very interesting phenomenon, an asymmetry actually in our way how we communicate. So what are values? Something that matters to live the life you and we like. It's a very general approach, as you see. Where hide the values? You have to look for words that deal with should, must, have to do, or not to do. So directional. There are also words that refer to the future. Future welfare, health, income. And also words that refer to respect. You should respect something, or you like to respect something. Nature, living, women, me. This is a other slide, just giving a little bit additional ethical theory. In ethics, we distinguish between three groups of argumentations that actually justify a specific decision. You might justify decisions on desired state. So you're looking to the benefits in the future of happiness, well-being, pleasure, relief, fulfillment. So you refer to kind of next time utopia. And there are right actions. Yeah? And the principle of respect for dignity, fairness, justice, etc. And virtues, that is the third one. I didn't discuss that yet with you. That is more personal. For a person, you can say, well, the character of that person shows responsibility. So it is very personal, valued statement that you make. This person is responsible, another one that. Honesty, loyalty are also options, but there are many more. Let's do some exercises with this scheme. This is a general overview of the types of values that you will meet behind all kinds of text. Take, for instance, two persona. At the top, you see Mary. This is a health provider. And Mary, the health provider, is very ambitious and she wants to help patients and she do it very respectful. And the lower person that you see there over there is John and he is a lawyer. Let's see when we ask Mary what kind of values she prioritizes most. And then is this what she will answer? So in a desired state, well-being is something that she really put high on the agenda for herself. Right actions, there is respect for dignity, fair and equality are important values for her. And in the person of virtues, you see responsibility and honesty. When we ask John the same question, we will see over there that in the desired states, a lot of values are valued, not maybe very high, but they are higher than the usual way. And in the second column, you see that justice is one of the main favorites. And in his virtues, charity and loyalty. What will happen when those two come together in a room? They meet each other. Will they be communicating persons at that moment, or do they have a problem? And they have quite a problem, I will show you. As you see, Mary has most of her priority values in the second column, the right action. And you see that John has most of the priority values in the first column, the desired states. Desired states is a way to say, I'm doing this because in the future there will some payoff and the future will be better than now. The right actions has to do with what I'm doing today. I really feel that it's good to do, whatever the consequences might be in the future. So Mary, as a health provider, she is daily working with respect for dignity, fairness to the patients, and equality in treating the different patients. So that is clear. That is a part of her way of value system. John, on the other hand, you see, he likes well-being, pleasure, and fulfillment very much, but his main issue is actually the justice in the other one, but there's only one, and charity and loyalty in the other one. But he actually sees this well-being and pleasure more as something that will come in the desired state later on, not today, but later on. So it may be after work, but it might be also after 20 years. When those two people are going to discuss with each other, they use a different grammar. The grammar about now my act is justified is completely different than my act is only justified after 20 years. Mary will regard that argument as a not acceptable argument because that is a kind of speculation, something that people doing with the stock markets, that is not that really helps the people at this moment. So it is very logical that Mary is someone in the health sector And John is someone in the lawyer sector. Is there a problem, actually, and can it be helped? Yes, there is some room for improvement in the relationship between Mary and John. There are shared values, as you see here in green. Happiness and well-being are both shared by, so as well as Mary as John. This is a good starting point to bring the people together to discuss it. And then from that point, try to explore as two persons to what extent the other orientation and values actually will irritate you or can be experienced at the same way as a kind of complementary addition in the relationship. That is just for those two people. But you can also imagine that this might happen for a lot of other groups. It's not people, but also groups. And when you have groups, you have to think about, for instance, vegans and pig farmers, but you can also think about conservatives and for instance, Democrats or the Tories and the Liberal parties. Well, then you have the same kind of differences in all kinds of value patterns. This is an example. You can look to, for instance, to the court. There's an accused, there's a public prosecutor, there are lawyers, there are media, there's family, and they all have, again, some kind of priority values in this specific multi-actor situation. And when you all delineate them and find out where they are and what types they are, you can do that by interviews, but you can also do it by just thinking what will be of the complete list of all kinds of values, the most probable ones that they will adhere to, then you can have an overview where are the tensions actually. And we do it the same again, fill it in and try to find it out. And we see some tensions between, for instance, the accused and the family, that is, well, for sure. There might be also something positive between the accused and the lawyer, maybe in a different kind of column, somewhere about the rights and the principles. And there might be, of course, all kinds of conflicts or tensions in each column, actually. So individuals and groups can be characterized by a value pattern, as you see. And you see also that I summarize where is the basic value conflict problem between the dominant class of motivational value, remember the green blocks, and where is a ground for solution and mediation and recommendations, and that are the shared values. So here a longer list, what you can imagine as kind of values in the three different families. And now I give you some examples of research that is actually using this kind of value analysis. And this is a very interesting researcher, Hofstede, who did a lot of research all over the world and was able to characterize a country or a company in all kinds of different countries. And you see a kind of, say, accents. And here you see three countries online, the Netherlands, Japan, and East Africa. And you see, in, for instance, in the EDV, that means the individuality index, that is usually referred to Americans and American attitude, that is around 100% individuality. The Dutch are a little bit lower, but in this comparison, the top one. And you see the East African people, they are much more group and family oriented. The extended family is very important in the African culture. You see Japan in the middle, and a lot of Southeast countries are also a little bit in the middle, but groupthink is very important. So the value of the group is quite dominant still. When I take another example, that is this one, the UAI, that is the Uncertainty Avoidance Index. And you see that Japan is scoring sky high. And that actually means that they avoid as much as possible a situation in which they don't have control. So they ritualized all kinds of ways of activities. When you're going for an interview or you're going for a consultation, you will come in a clean office and there is a person who is very politely dressed already, behaves politely, so you can expect clearly what is over there. When you're going for hiking in the mountains, you just buy all the outfits necessary for hiking in the mountains and then you go for hiking. When you're going to play tennis, you buy all the outfits for tennis and then you're going for tennis. That gives them security. On the other hand, you see some Dutch people in the lower picture over there that they are having a workshop on expressive dance, and probably they are now depicting a flying bird or something like that. And that's a kind of, say, trying to see what your talents are, just to improvise. And that is something that you don't have to do that with Japanese people. They don't feel really embarrassed when they are coming this kind of workshop. And then you see the differences. And you see, we have our African friends on the same level, actually, and we can do a lot of the same in dancing. How do we come from recommendation for policy action? This is the last part that I'm going to discuss with you, because analysis has to come to some kind of action. I like to discuss a very interesting square, matrix, table, how you call it. As you see, this is a table that actually combines the first and the second order level. So in the first order level, on the left side of the column, you see consensus about factual knowledge. Do you have consensus with other parties or with other people? Or yes or no, this is two options. And then the second order, the value layer, is there consensus about values? No consensus. Or yes consensus, you have to realize that when you ask it to people, that they say, of course, I'm convinced of my values are the best. So it is not about a kind of idea in the minds of the people. It is that you see that vegans, for instance, and farmers have not the same values regarding how to deal with animals, as an example. And what is interesting is in this, is that you can make four different kinds of problems. You have an unstructured problem, that means that there is no consensus and no factual knowledge where is kind of consensus about. So that is, everything is debated, values are debated, and factual knowledge is debated. And we call that the worst case scenario, and that is an unstructured problem. On the other down point of the matrix, you see the structured problem. And there you have consensus about the values. You know it is good to have some treatment for cancer. And there is a lot of consensus about the data that you have now. And then you say, okay, in the future, we have to take this kind of therapy because there's consensus about, say, the balance of the detrimental side effects of the therapy, and there's consensus about the possible gain in it. So, and all the data is also in line with that. So we make it a rule or policy and stimulation and put it on the list of refundable therapies. Well, then you have two other sides. There's a moderate structured problem on the right top. And you see, moderate structure problems is consensus about the definition of the problem, the values and the goals of the policy, but very uncertain how this actually works in a technical sense, in the first order world. And the other way around, you see on the left down block. Interestingly about this is that those four blocks also relates on the basis of a lot of reviews to winning recommendation, winning policy changes, and the ones that you it's not so smart to apply it. The moment when you start simple downright, there you see a policy as regulation, and the appropriate approach is the for a structural problem. So when it is structured, you can just start again to set up a regulation. This is the happy world for most of the people in the government. The worst case scenario is again on the left top. There you have no consensus and no concern about factual knowledge. There you need policy as a learning process. And it means that you have to set up focus groups. You have to set up all kinds of public consultations. You have to have discussions with different groups together and find an answer to it. So not pretending government that you can regulate it. No, when you try to do that, all the people will become quite irritated because they don't feel them taken seriously. And the other two, there is policy as negotiation. It's appropriate a way for, and what is written out there? Oh yes, that is it. A moderately structured problem, and the other one is accommodation. Just look in the literature for Hirschmüller and Dunn. Dunn is an American philosopher on policy sciences, and you will find a lot of examples dealing with this kind of combination. A summary. Look for the value patterns that connect between persons, groups and parties, that hinder between persons, groups and parties also, and formulate recommendations. Stakeholder meetings are important based on shared values. Adopt policy strategy to the level of fact and value combinations, the scheme that I just showed you. I wish you a good day. Chartercock winning. Thank you.